In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I always start with a piece of music. And so my strong temptation was to base my message today on something like this, which of course is anything Leonard Cohen. This won't be the one I base my message on. It's the one I selected to give you the opening strains of. The one that I would have used of his, the lyrics really, even in my standards, aren't quite comfortable in church. But it was one about democracy. But on rereading all the scriptures, I decided that what I want to speak about today is really something that takes me back to my grade 10 classroom at Frontenac Secondary School. And Mr. Gord Hawkins was my teacher. And he introduced me to a piece of music that literally transformed my life. And it was the first time I ever thought, oh, that's religious. There's something in that. And over the years, it has become the song that, to me, epitomizes what Jesus must have felt in the anguish of him trying to get a message out to the world. It was this one, the one that led me to ministry.
Echo
was a vision of the world as they saw it. And I want to talk to you about vision. That's the vision that Jesus spoke of, the lamb and the wolf together. The one down below is the vision we've all been looking at, believe it or not. So, a little lesson from motorcycle riding. It's kind of counterintuitive, but if you're going down the road on a motorcycle, you will only go where you are looking. So, if you want to know where you're going to go, look ahead. If you want to go to the ditch, look to the ditch. And that's the truth. Motorcycle riding is also counterintuitive because to do a long sweeping curve to the right or to the left, you actually have to push your body weight against the handlebars in the opposite direction. So if I want to go, you know how you turn a wheel like this on a car? You want to go right, you go this way. If I push my handlebar on the bike that way, I will go that way. You go in the direction to what you push. Excuse me, I just said it backwards. You go the other way. You go, if I want to go left, I push right. It's easier to do when you're doing it instinctively than to explain. It's like try to explain tying shoes. So what I want to say is that where we go is where we look. And why that bottom picture? Do you recognize the bottom picture? Doc Brown and Marty McFly with the famous DeLorean from Back to the Future. You all remember the movies? The first one, Marty McFly, goes back into 1955. And he makes some changes to correct some breaks in history to make his present day the way it should be. The writers of Back to the Future picked 30-year time frames. So in 1985, they released Back to the Future 1 and put Marty McFly 30 years earlier to when his parents were young. When they released Back to the Future 2, they went 30 years to the future. And they took Marty McFly to a time when his son would be grown up. And the time they foresaw was a dystopian future where things had gone wrong. Now here's the irony. In 2015, a year ago, actually a year and a half ago, was the big celebrations and the re-release of the whole trilogy of movies on the 30th anniversary of the movies. Because the year they went to was 2015. And in the dystopian future, they confessed at that time, almost 2 years ago when they were getting ready, they confessed that they modeled it on an image of a day when a billionaire businessman who was a racist misogynist would have taken control of the United States. And they actually, at that time, stated they actually had press releases showing pictures of Donald Trump as the person they modeled that character off, this Biff Tannen character off, and they did that in 1985. And I say that not because I want to make political comments, but because there's a lot of... Don't touch the button. There's a lot of stuff in the press about where we are today, where the world is today, what things are about today, and about all the fear and all the anger and all the tensions and all the policies or non-policies or projects in this country, in other countries around the world, a sense of malaise in this world that we have been looking at for some time now. So here's the deal. You go where you look. Life is counterintuitive into what you push towards. I grew up in the days of which this song, Sounds of Silence, were written, when the writers were again looking at that land where people weren't listening, where people were writing songs that no one heard, the speaker was trying to send a message out, no one was listening, no one was hearing, no one was seeing. And I have always equated that to Jesus Christ speaking out to all of us through scripture, through life, through experience, and we're not listening. And I learned this song at the same time they sat me down with a book from George Orwell called 1984. And then there was the chrysalids. Do you remember all these? Dystopian futures. They have taught us to look for the worst. And you go where you look. You go where you look. And against the backdrop of that have been people like myself who have been openly called naive and unrealistic. Because I hold up a different value in my personal life, which is that things just don't have to be this bad. That there is another way. There is a way of faith. There is a way to believe exactly what was said in Isaiah, that the lamb and the wolf will feed together, will lay down together. That the lion and the bear, and you go through Isaiah and he's got millions of references to it. Well, not millions, but you know, lots of references to this type of future. But we have to understand the power of God working in us. And when no one listened to Isaiah, when no one listened to Ezekiel, when no one listened to Elijah, when no one listened to Malachi or Haggai or any of the other prophets, we got Jesus of Nazareth. And man, if you won't listen to that, what will you listen to? And I'm not talking politically. I'm talking personally. Because all the rest of that changes when we personally feel it. What you see determines what you have chosen to see. That might give an impression of the obvious, but it's true. It's not an intentional optimism or a glass half full kind of philosophy. It is the true claim of the true hope we have in God. Our God who is still present and powerful. And when it looks like we or the church are powerless in the face of all that seems to be working against the kingdom of God, we have to look again. As Jesus said, as for all those things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down. What things will we see? What things will we see in our churches? In one another? In our nation? In our world? Because what we see is what we can testify to. And we must testify to the love of God working in this world. When all else is lost, hope is not. Hope for ourselves. What do you see? I live in a world where I hear complaints. Complaints about people, complaints about issues, complaints about things. And I've discovered along the way that what some people see just isn't real. A neighbor complaining about what somebody's doing and saying, oh, they're out there to aggrandize themselves. And I look at them and go, no, they're not. No, they're not. Do you not even know their story? Do you know where they come from? Do you know why things are being done that way? No one looks for the backstory. No one looks underneath. No one looks for the understanding. an understanding is what we must have first, because with understanding comes compassion. And with allowing compassion to embrace our life, we just envelop ourselves with a concept of what love really is. And then we understand God's process at work in us. And what we see is what we will say. And I mean this directly. I mean this as I address emails, as I address comments, as I address all kinds of things. Because if you see women as objects, you will speak of them as objects. If you see people of other color as those who matter less, then you won't speak up for them. If you see God as your judge and jury, then you will speak about other people as deserving condemnation. What is the God you see? What is the God you feel? How, in God's name, does any of this address our personal lives? Because it really comes down to the power of the church is the power of God working in its people. You are the people of God. It just becomes, what do you see? And what do you see in yourself? And I can say that as I stand here and look at you, I see hope. And I do see understanding. And I do see love. And I do see compassion. And I also see that against a life where many have felt tattered, torn, fearful, and tired. But then we understand God knows that too. And God cares. And I know it because a year ago today, I stood up in this pulpit and yelled at you. Because I was traumatized. Because I was frightened. Because I was fearful. For a simple fact that a cafe I had eaten in the week before was blown up in France. And I was terrified. And I know that you responded to me over the coming months and years and have made me a better person. That's the power of God at work. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.